I'm Dying Laughing by Christina Stead. The book is subtitled The Humorist. For William Blake, novelist and economist, my friend and husband, who helped me from the beginning. The mockeries are not you. The pert apparel, the deformed attitude, drunkenness, greed, premature death, all these I part aside. Through angers, losses, ambition, ignorance, ennui, what you are picks its way. Walt Whitman, to you, Birds of Passage, 1881. Preface. Christina Stead paid her first visit to the U.S. in 1935. In New York, she and William Blake, who was an American citizen, were to become associated with the magazine New Masses and to meet writers and others of the radical left. She and Blake were back in Europe again in the following year, but returned in 1937 to the U.S., where they lived throughout World War II. The second stay was the period in which she wrote and published The Man Who Loved Children, 1940, For Love Alone, 1944, and Letty Fox, Her Luck, 1946. The Man Who Loved Children and Letty Fox were set in the United States, as were the next two novels, which came out after her return to Europe in 1947, A Little Tea, A Little Chat, 1948, and The People with the Dogs, 1952. This book, I'm Dying Laughing, published now for the first time, is the only other novel of hers which grew out of the years she spent in America. The decades of the 30s, 40s, and 50s were critical times, culminating for the radical left in the McCarthy witch hunts conducted through the House Committee on Un-American Activities and the trial of the Hollywood Ten in 1947 and 8. In a radio interview in July 1973, Stead spoke of the terrific convulsion in the USA in the 30s, and then of the McCarthy period as follows. It was very unpleasant. So many people, good, worthy people, were being attacked, and it was entirely for the worst political motives. They didn't care about Reds. There weren't enough Reds. They were all making their political ways, as some have done, of course. Oh, it was a terrific moment. It was worth living through. It was great. The novelist shows out in that final sentence. From this period comes I'm Dying Laughing, which is based, in Stead's usual way, on the fortunes of people she knew at first hand. In an interview in June 1973, Stead described I'm Dying Laughing, which for a time she had dropped, in this way. It was all about the passion of, I use passion in almost the religious sense, of two people, two Americans, New Yorkers, in the 30s. They're doing well, but they suffered all the troubles of the 30s. They were politically minded. They went to Hollywood. They came to Europe to avoid the McCarthy trouble. Of course, they were deeply involved. And then they lived around Europe, oh, in a wild and exciting, extravagant style. But there was nothing to support it. They wanted to be on the side of the angels, good communists, good people, and also to be very rich. Well, of course, they came to a bad end. The earliest sketches for I'm Dying Laughing begin in the late 1940s. By September 1950, living in Montreux, Stead was down to serious work on the novel, then entitled The Renegade. UNO 1945 appeared in a special Christina Stead issue of Southerly in 1962 as chapter one of an unpublished novel, I'm Dying Laughing. The writing of other books had intervened in the 1950s, Cotter's England and Miss Herbert, both to be published years later. By 1966, Stead had completed I'm Dying Laughing and sent the manuscript to the United States. Many Americans had by then discovered, with the Stanley Burnshaw-inspired reissue of The Man Who Loved Children, originally published in New York 26 years earlier, that Stead was a great writer. The time might have seemed right for another big novel. As it happened, she was urged to revise her manuscript to make the political background of the 1940s and subsequent events clearer. This she set out to do, and for the next 10 years or more she worked on and off rewriting and revising. She came, rightly or wrongly, to regret this decision, and to believe that she should have left the book, whatever its shortcomings, as it was. Working at it for so long, she felt that she was being drawn into writing a different novel, and into sacrificing some of the force of the original version. In a letter of April 1979 to me as her future literary trustee, Christina Stead wrote that I was free to publish I'm Dying Laughing after her death, if I thought fit. She seemed to assume that the manuscript, after all those years of rewriting, was in a publishable form. What I inherited in 1953 was a huge mass of typescript, ranging in finish from rough to polished, and in length from page bits to different versions of whole chapters, along with piles of basic and supplementary material. The typescript for the novel presented further editorial complications. The names of characters, their relationships, their ages, and sometimes their appearances, had undergone changes over the years, and the pagination was often misleading. The greatest difficulties occurred in what now stands as part one of the novel. The opening chapter, UNO 1945, of the 1966 version here becomes chapter four, since much of the reworking of the early manuscript was designed to provide in an additional three chapters more information about the earlier years of Emily and Stephen, in order to account for their difficulties with the Communist Party in the U.S. in the 1940s. In this process, the present chapters 5 to 10 underwent considerable changes. Part 2 posed fewer problems. I've incorporated, wherever possible, Stead's handwritten emendations, and have followed the excisions she made in the original manuscript. The first draft of the novel went straight through from chapter 12 to the end without chapter divisions. As an aid to reading, and in order to bring Part 2 in line structurally with Part 1, I've split this large body of material into separate chapters and have provided headings for what now become chapters 13 through 24. I'm Dying Laughing is the most obviously political of all Christina Stead's books, but it is not a political novel in the manner of Kessler's Darkness at Noon or Orwell's 1984. Given its economic, social, and political background, I'm Dying Laughing is concerned primarily with character and morality. Stead was quite clear about this in her accounts of the writing and rewriting. Americans, she said, have short memories, even for crucial events, but she felt that she had neither the talent nor the desire to remind them of their political history. She once described what was originally her first chapter and its relationship to the rest of the novel as follows. "It is full of energy and a sort of a picture of the whole book in a way, except that I meant it to go from fire to more fiery to fierier still. It has a very terrible dramatic end. I wanted it to be a build-up all the way through. But you can't do that putting in political explanations." Emily and Stephen are the true center. Theirs is a story of destructive passion, misguided idealism and wasted talent, of self-indulgence, folly, and betrayal. Emily now joins the gallery of Christina Stead's most memorable characters, which includes Catherine and Michael Bagneau, Aristide Racamon, Henri Léon, Sam, Henny, and Louisa Paulet, Teresa Hawkins, Jonathan Crowe, Honor Lawrence, and Nellie Cook. Stead liked to think of her books as her children, to be reared and then sent out to take their chance in the world once the time came. After many years, I'm dying laughing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.